We are looking live here at the Ramsey Center. Ryan Keyes here with Phil Jackson. And Phil, we've got a barn burn type of matchup here today as two North Division foes in the SoCon, Western Carolina and Samford, ready to go head-to-head.
Absolutely. Ryan. Very two similar teams tonight. Statistically, they're almost identical in every aspect. Both teams like to get out and run. Both teams force a lot of turnovers along with turning the ball over a lot. So I think that's going to be key tonight. Also, both teams like to shoot the three. Samford leads the Southern Conference in three-point field goals at 8.4 per game. Also ranked nationally in number 16. So look for that to be key. Also, we know Weston likes to shoot the ball as well, especially behind Keaton Cole.
Especially behind Keaton Cole. Keaton Cole finished with 10 three-pointers last week to give him 91 on the season. December 1st, Western Carolina traveled to Samford, which is in Alabama, to play the Bulldogs. Lost 75-71. However, they are 5-0 here in the Ramsey Center. How big of a difference does the home crowd make here tonight, Kid Phil?
Well, I think it makes a huge difference. Western has struggled a little bit overall this season. However, they're 7-4, 7-4 here in the Ramsey Center. So they always play better here at home. A little bit of home cooking going on. So look for that to carry over into tonight's matchup.
The crowd letting them hear it as the team comes out. And Phil, what are some of your keys to today's game for both teams?
Well, as I said earlier, I think both teams, it's going to come down to three-point shooting. Samford likes to shoot the ball. We know Western likes to shoot the ball. So both teams very similar, up and down style. And so I honestly think that it's going to come down to whoever has the ball last in tonight's matchup. It's going to be a close one.
All right, Phil. Now we're going to try to send it down to Jake Myers, our sideline reporter, for his pregame thoughts. Jake?
All right. Thank you, Ryan. And as you mentioned in the pregame, Keaton Cole had 10 three-pointers last week. He had the four in the first meeting against Samford, and I looked to see him hopefully light it up from behind the arc early. They come home back to the Ramsey Center, which is a big boost after that big road win against Elon on Saturday. And they're looking for their first three-game win streak of the season, and hopefully they can bring it out tonight. And I also look for them to try to out-rebound Samford on the boards, take control of the glass with Tawoski inside. I think that's going to be a big key, as well as turnovers. And hopefully they can jump out to an early lead and see what they can do the rest of the game. So back to you, Ryan.
Thank you, Jake. And Jake mentioned turnovers, Phil. It's been a problem at times with the Catamounts, as has fouls. How do the Catamounts stay composed, stay disciplined in their game tonight?
Well, when they have the ball offensively, they have to just stay calm. As we've seen all season long, they've had some trouble against the press. Teams have been bringing the full court pressure. It's caused some problems. That's where the majority of the turnovers come from. And sometimes they lead to easy baskets on the other end for the opposing team. So the Catamounts need to limit their turnovers. Just be very smart. Take your time handling the basketball when they are faced with full court pressure.
Now, Samford's got a star, a true freshman named Rajon Kelly, who moved in to the starting lineup on January 7th against the Citadel. He averages 11.5 points, almost four boards, and two assists a game. How will the Catamounts be able to adjust to a player like that that can do it all?
Well, I think defensively, they're on a hot streak, Western is. The past two games, they won on the road, last outing against Elon. They played well defensively the last home game against the Citadel. They forced a lot of turnovers, so I don't think defending him will be a problem. They've done that all season long. They shut down, for the most part, Eric Ferguson from Chattanooga. So defensively, I think Western's a very solid team. They shouldn't have much problem containing him.
And that's something that we've talked about throughout the basketball season for both men's and women's, is the idea of defense. It seems to be a philosophy of both Coach Karen Middleton on the girls' side and also Coach Hunter here with the men's. And if you can play solid defensive ball from night to night, yeah, you'll have rough offensive nights every now and then, but the balls should be able to find the hoop at some point.
And we've all heard the saying that defense wins ball games, and that's exactly right. Like you said, even if you're struggling offensively, if you're playing good defense, you give yourself a chance every night to come out with a victory.
Thank you, Phil. We are going to send it down to the PA announcer for the national anthem and starting lineups for both Western Carolina and Samford.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Ramsey Center on the campus of Western Carolina University for this evening's Southern Conference Men's College Basketball game between the visiting Samford University Bulldogs and your Western Carolina University Catamounts. Now let's meet the starting lineups for tonight's game. First, the visiting Bulldogs, starting at one guard, a 6'6 senior from Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, number 5, Jeffrey Merritt. At another guard, a 6'4 freshman from St. Paul, Minnesota, number 11, Rayshon Kelly. At a third guard, a 6'4 sophomore from Dallas, Texas, number 24, Will Cook. At a fourth, a 6'6 freshman from Kingston, Tennessee, number 35, Tyler Hood. And at center, a 6'9 sophomore from South Milwaukee, Wisconsin, number 1, Drew Winkler. The Bulldogs head coach is Jimmy Tillett, assisted by Paul Kelly, Lee Burgess, and Terrence Johnson.
The WCU Cat House Band right there with the national anthem. And Phil, as we get ready for tip-off, we talked a lot about Keaton Cole and his three-point shooting. We've seen it all year long, like we mentioned in pregame, 91 three-pointers on the season. He's got a great percentage from beyond the arc. How big of a difference can that make for the Catamounts offense today?
Well, it can make a huge difference. If he's not hitting his shots, a lot of times they struggle offensively. He provides that shot and arm they need a lot of times if they are down by hitting a couple of shots. He can also erase the deficit in a hurry if he is on. As you said, he hit 10 three-pointers the other night, which is just remarkable. So anytime you can hit 91 three-pointers in the season, that's just amazing.
Catamounts break the huddle. They're setting up for the tip-off here in what should be a great game between a team And Samford, who's 11-16 on the year, 8-8 in the SoCon. Western Carolina, 12-17, 6-10 in the SoCon, looking to get a tie with Appalachian State, moving into a game on Saturday with huge implications.
West needs to be careful, though, not to look ahead to the big showdown against Appalachian State. You're at home now against Samford. You'd be worried about Samford. Take care of business tonight.
That's a great point, and a lot of that has to do with coaching. Phil, Larry Hunter, very disciplined head coach. You can bet that he is focused on this game as Drew Windler, the sophomore out of Samford, tried to post up there, could not get that one to fall, and now Brandon Boggs with the ball for Western. Keaton Cole sends it to Sumler, who gets it to Boggs. Down low to Tawoski King. Tawoski tries to post up, sends it back out. Sumler setting up a pick from Mutombo, well defended by Samford. Boggs fakes a shot, fakes it again, gets it to Sumler, a shot from downtown before the shot clock went off, and that one goes off the rim and out.
That was good team defense right there by Samford. They didn't allow Weston to get the look they wanted. They were very stout on defense.
Windler with the ball sets up. Kelly, the freshman, we talked about him in pregame, and right there he puts on a layup. Sumler with the ball gets out the box. Cole thought about it, thought better of it. He has the ball again, sends it over to Sumler. Gets it down to Mutombo. Boggs a three, and he hits it.
Brandon Boggs
from downtown. You don't expect it from him, but right there, a big shot to put the Cats up by one.
That's a good shot there by Boggs. Usually we're talking about Sumler, Cole, and Mutombo when it comes to scoring, but if Boggs can be that fourth scorer, it's going to make it very hard for Samford to defend all four of those guys.
Pass inside to Will Cook, broken up by Trey Sumler, and we talk about Trey's athleticism and his offensive prowess, but right there, the defense working pretty well for him, too. Jeffrey Merritt now with the ball, gets it over to Kelly. Hood inside to Merritt, looking to post up Boggs. Draws contacts, no call, and Boggs will come up with the rebound.
Merritt was looking for a foul in that play, but I didn't see a whole lot of contact. Just good defense by the Catamounts.
Catamounts ran the ball down the court. Bit of an errant pass to Keaton Cole. He handled it. Tried to set up the offense a little bit. It's defended by Samford, but knocked out of bounds, and it'll be Catamounts ball. Sumler sets up Mutombo for three, and he drains it. We talk about Keaton Cole's three-point range, but right now it's Boggs and Mutombo hitting the deep shots, and the Cats are up by four early.
Well, right now Samford's running a zone defensively, and anytime you run a zone, you leave yourself vulnerable to the outside shooting. And like a team like Western, that could be very bad.
And right there, we saw a lot of confidence from Mutombo because he wasn't left that much of a cushion, but he did not hesitate on that shot. And, Phil, you worked the Pink Zone game a couple days ago, and Mutombo had a huge game. We're really seeing him. I mean, he is a redshirt senior. He's had good game for a long time, but we're really seeing him this season coming into his own even more and has a lot of confidence in his game right now.
Yeah, well, he's stepping up like a senior should do. It's his last year. He's down to his final two home games, so he's playing big-time basketball right at the right time.
Tawoski King with a block on Kelly. Right now, we've seen great defense from the Catamounts. We talked about it in pregame. Right now, they're backing up our talk, and here's Boggs. He cannot put home that shot, but not a bad look. Kelly gets it out to Merritt. He's going to send it to Hood. Cook gets it to Windler, and the center throwing up a three-pointer for Samford. Keaton Cole, his first look from downtown. He can't hit it. And Phil, what were your thoughts on that shot?
Well, I thought that was a bit of a quick shot. It was very early in the shot clock. You don't necessarily have to jack it up real quick. Instead of looking for a quick shot, look for the best shot.
And this is a team that when they've been patient offensively, they have been lethal. Right here, Trey Sumler for three. Wide open. They're actually going to call that one a two as he was on the line, but beautiful shot and great offensive production off that inbounds pass. And that just goes to show, Phil, I mean, we talk about Trey Sumler's driving ability, but right there, outside shooting works for him as well. So if you're Samford, how do you cover that?
Well, it's going to be kind of difficult because Box hit a shot early, Matumbo hit a shot early. Obviously, you got to worry about Keaton Cole. Now Sumler, he's getting his shots from the outside. If all four of those guys are hitting their shots today, it's going to be very difficult for Samford to contain that, especially if they're sitting back in the zone. It's going to leave holes on the perimeter.
Keaton Cole had an open look. He couldn't hit it that time, and Windler puts it off the glass on the other end for two. Samford down by one here. We're getting exactly what we expected early, a defensive close game as Boggs throws up another three and hits it again. Look out for Brandon Boggs. He is a streaky type of player, and right now he's on fire.
We talked about in the pregame how the three-point shooting was going to be very key for both teams, and right now both teams aren't being shy. They're out there jacking it up, as there goes Cook right there with one of his own.
Cook responds to Boggs' three, and right now we've got a shootout going on. Pretty good interior defense, but on the perimeter, guys are just nailing shots left and right. Boggs again from downtown. Couldn't hit that one, but Sumler with the rebound. Keaton Cole from 5 feet out from the arc, and he hits one.
I can't believe he took that shot. He was standing almost at the Catamount at midcourt when he let go of it, but nothing but the bottom of the net on that one. Keaton Cole definitely has range.
He's done it all season, Phil. I mean, time and time again, if you leave this guy open, he doesn't care how far away from the basket he is.
And if these two teams keep up the pace they're going right now, Ryan, we may be eating tacos for lunch tomorrow.
Tacos and both teams will hit 100 points, as this is an NBA pace type of game right now. Samford can't hit the shot. Sumler looking to set up. Hits it out to Keaton Cole for three, and he hits it again. The Catamounts right there as Samford takes a timeout, it looks like, but Samford misses the opportunity. Sumler runs it down the court, doesn't let the defense set up, and you hit Keaton Cole on the outside for a wide open shot. Now, Phil, we've noticed right now, I mean, this is one of those games where That last play is a perfect example of it. You have to hit your shots because not only are you going to get buried on the scoreboard if you miss them, but then you set up transition buckets on the other end.
Absolutely. And on top of missing a shot, Samford played terrible defense, not getting back in time. And Weston likes to run the basketball. If they get an opportunity, they're going to get out and run. And so they're either going to take it all the way to the basket, get fouled and hit the free throw line, or they're going to kill you shooting the ball outside, which so far they've been doing.
In Samford's defense, Western probably one of the most athletic teams in the SoCon, and they put in another athletic player in James Sinclair, gives Samford something else to think about after that timeout. Windler posts up and puts it up again, and Windler is a 6'9 player out of Wisconsin, and right now he's prompting a bit of a problem down low.
Well, he had 18 points his last outing against Chattanooga. And so that's not a surprise that he's hitting his shot. The big man will step it outside, take a three-pointer, he'll also take the inside. Very versatile player.
And it doesn't seem like the Catamounts have a player with enough size to really guard him effectively. Hood tried to set up Windler again, gets it to Cook. Pops it out to Kelly. Kelly gonna drive. Couldn't get the layup up, but he got it out to Windler. Desperation play works for Samford. Cook for three at the buzzer and hits it to bring Samford back within two. And Phil, that play all started with Kelly messing up on the original layup opportunity, but then kicking it back out to Windler while he was on the ground.
Yeah, that's just a good example of not giving up on the play. Keep the ball alive, give your teammates a chance.
Mutombo sets up Sumler from the outside, and he... Nothing but mesh right there from the outside as Trey Sumler benefits from Mutombo's good offensive board, sends it back out to the outside, and right now the Catamounts just hot from beyond the arc.
Good defense sent by Sinclair there. I was almost able to poke it away.
Wendler looking to post up on Kenny Hall again. Shoots that one from the outside, almost a Tim Duncan-ish type of attempt, but he couldn't get it to go.
I think Hall may have gotten a piece of that one to alter the shot.
Mutombo driving, but walks with it. Good call by the official. We've got a media timeout here, so we'll take our first break of the game. When we come back, we'll send it down to our sideline reporter, Jake Myers. Until then, 2015, the Catamounts up here in the Ramsey Center. We are back here at the Ramsey Center. I'm going to send it down to Jake Myers for a sideline report. Jake, take it away.
All right, thank you. Right now, as Phil alluded to in the pregame, defense was a real big step up improvement for last week. And early on in the going, they're doing really good at pressuring the Samford Bulldogs. And the crowd's really getting into it. They're loving it. They're loving the intensity. They're loving the fast break opportunities. And also, the Catamount threes have been coming at full force. They've already hit six in the first half. And Trey on that last big three, Keaton Cole was up on the bench standing up. Everybody's getting excited on the bench. It's looking like a big energy boost for the Catamounts as this game goes forward. Back to you, Ryan.
Thank you, Jake. And Phil, Jake mentioned energy on the bench, especially from those three-pointers, also the fast break opportunities. If you can get this bench on their feet and you can get some of these young players going, because the Catamounts have a very young team, you can really have a lot of success here in the Ramsey Center.
Definitely. And also, if you're excited on the bench, you're going to be excited when you get put in the game. The Catamounts are very deep. They play a lot of guys. So those guys are all jacked up on the sidelines, waiting for their opportunity. When they get into the game, that excitement will carry over to their play once they get on the court.
Catamounts right now 6 for 12 from three-point range. In fact, they only have taken two field goals that weren't from three-point range. Very Duke-esque type of performance right now, but the question is, do you try to maintain that? Or do you try to start working the interior game as Samford makes an adjustment towards the perimeter?
Well, I think you got to work it inside just to keep the defense honest. If you continue to hit your shots, I mean, that's fine. But eventually Samford's going to come up with a defensive scheme to prevent that from happening. Also, who's to say that Weston doesn't go through a cold streak? To go through a cold streak, you got to have other means of offense. So I think you need to work it in to Watson King, Kenny Hall, maybe get something going in the paint. Maybe try to get fouled and get to the free throw line. We've yet to see any free throws today.
That's a good point, Phil. And with all honesty, the Catamounts haven't been bad from the interior, really. They've just popped it back outside to wide open jump shots. So it's made sense. They actually have three offensive rebounds. And when you can get that, I mean, we saw Mutombo set up similar to the outside after he got the offensive board. They're generating second chance opportunities. Samford has not so far. And that's a big part of the five-point lead.
Also, we've seen very unselfish basketball by Western on the offensive side, working the ball around the perimeter, looking for a good shot.
Ismael Hollis jacks up a long two, couldn't quite get it to fall, but a turnover forced by James Sinclair, and the Catamounts have the ball right back.
And that's what he does. Sinclair comes off the bench. He doesn't really look to score. He plays great defense, and he's just a headache for a lot of teams when offensively. He's got very long arms, very athletic feet. He's a very athletic player, so he pokes the ball away. He gets his hand on a lot of balls, tips balls. He forces a lot of turnovers. So he's a good role player for the Catamounts when he comes off the bench.
Tawoski King called there for a walk or a double dribble, something along those lines. So it'll be Samford ball again. And Tawoski right there down low had a little trouble handling Sumler's pass, and that probably is what resulted in the turnover. Merritt sends it to Friday. Samford down low. It was Miller. He couldn't get it to fall, but an offensive rebound. Friday setting up the offense. Gets the cook. He loses it. It's going to be a kick ball on Tawoski King as that ball came loose and just hit off of King's foot. Accidental contact, but kick ball's pretty cut and dry there.
Brandon Boggs now checks in the game, so let's see if he continues his hot shooting.
Lob pass on the inbounds, and they're going to send it out to Merritt from downtown. Couldn't get it, and Tawoski King comes up with the rebound. Sumler looking to set up the offense, sets up a pick. well defended by Samford. And that's one thing that Samford's defense has done very well, taking away that pick and drive that Sumler loves to use. Sumler comes up with the rebound. He's going to run the court here. Gets it to Brandon Boggs. Open two. In and out for Boggs. And you mentioned it earlier, Boggs hot early, but right there cannot get that good look to fall.
Yeah, and both teams seem a little cold after that last timeout. They've yet to score since coming out of the timeout, throwing up a lot of crazy shots like that one right there. So both teams need to settle down right now.
Sumler hits it out to Keaton Cole. Fakes, shot, and nails it from downtown. What a play from Keaton Cole. And if you're Samford, how do you stop that? Because you have to get up in the air and try to get a hand in his face on the initial shot. But if he doesn't take it, goes underneath and shoots it again, what are you supposed to do?
Right now, I think that's also because they're still in the zone. I think if they were to switch to man-to-man and maybe put a taller player, more athletic player on Keaton Cole, it'd be really difficult for him to shoot over him, especially since he's only 5'10". So right now, I think if I'm the coach of Samford, I'm going to put a taller, more athletic defender on Keaton Cole to make sure Western beats me some other way than just him shooting the basketball.
Well, the reason why Samford might not be doing that is if you go to man-to-man, it's going to be easier for Sumler to set up those pick-and-roll plays that he's already tried to set up a couple times. The zone picks that up pretty well. Unfortunately for Samford, the zone leaves open jump shooters because you're not right on top of your man.
Looks like you got to pick your poison here on this one.
Trey Sumler takes it down the court, gets it to Mutombo. Back down low to Mutombo, working that interior game, and he's going to draw a foul on Matthew Friday, the senior out of Grapevine, Texas. Not bad defense there, Phil, but just a good individual effort down low by Mutombo.
It was good recognition by Mutombo, too. He understood he had a less athletic player on him, and so he took it right on in there, got the foul, headed to the free throw line.
And they moved Mutombo to guard this year. He used to play forward. They moved him to guard, and he's a 6'4", 200-pound guard. I mean, the combination of size and athleticism creates matchup problems regardless of whether you're a center like Friday is or a guard who is usually smaller.
Well, he's got a very versatile game. He hit a three-pointer earlier in today's game. We've seen him, he's a good free throw shooter. He gets to the line a lot. That's part of the reason why he was able to score 24 points the other night against the Citadel. So he's a very versatile player. He can score in many different ways. So I think moving him to a guard just shows Larry Hunter knows his stuff.
Connor Miller, the freshman from far out, giving Keaton Cole a taste of his own medicine as he hits a three for Samford. Boggs now trying to drive. Doesn't go up. Hits it out to Sumler. Three's open. He couldn't hit it that time. And Tawaski King's going to take a foul there, trying to go for the offensive board. And, Phil, that's been a problem throughout the season for Tawaski King. Just fouls that one. Pretty unnecessary when you think about it. He's not in good position for the board. Sometimes you just got to live to fight another day. And right there, he went for it. Gets a foul called against him.
Yeah, and he's too valuable to make mistakes like that. Western's very shallow. They're not very deep on the inside. They don't have a very big bench to go to when it comes to post players. So he's got to be a lot more smart than that. And going after an offensive rebound, that from here looked like he didn't have a much chance of getting to begin with.
And we mentioned the athleticism of the Catamounts, and athleticism doesn't lend itself necessarily to size. And in this team's case, very much so. I mean, their guards, some of them are bigger than what you would expect. But other than that, not a huge team by any means. Mutombo drove, but threw his shoulder down, and they're going to get him for a charge. And, Phil, that's the toughest call to make. How did you feel about that one?
I think he made the right call. If Mutombo goes straight up, who knows, maybe that's a blocking foul. But anytime you lower the shoulder like that, 9 times out of 10, you're getting called for an offensive foul.
We've got a media timeout here. Catamount's still up by 5. We'll be back with Jake Myers once again when we come back to TV62's coverage of Catamounts basketball. Welcome back to the Ramsey Center. I'm going to send it down to Jake Myers on the sideline. Jake, take it away.
All right, thanks once again, Ryan. Now, on the last couple defensive possessions, Larry Hunter and the assistant coaches have been really getting a lot more vocal to the team and getting them just to stiffen up a little bit more, getting a lot of easy baskets underneath a couple lately, but the bench is getting still a little fired up over the hustle plays down on the other end on the offensively for Haruna Mutombo and the other Catamounts. And I look to continue to see the crowd get involved with the big three-pointers that the Catamounts are bound to hit later in the game, and hopefully it'll get loud in here to stop a Samford run later in the game. So let's see what happens. Back to you, Ryan.
Thanks, Jake. And Jake mentioned crowd noise right there. We've had sort of a quiet crowd so far tonight, despite all the three-pointers. Samford's got a little run going right now as they're up by three. How do you get the crowd involved in the game if you're the Catamounts right now?
Well, I wish I knew the answer to that question. You figure with the impressive shooting that both teams are having right now, they'd be a little bit more excited. So I'm not really sure. It's the end of the week. Maybe they're tired.
Well, that's not an excuse in my opinion as Box hits another three. And, I mean, you got a point. Both of these teams are just putting on a show right now. I mean, fireworks all over the court. As Wendler will respond in the way that he does down low on the post.
And Ryan, it's just like we said it was going to be in the pregame. It's been very up and down, a lot of turnovers, a lot of three-point shots. Both teams right now are shooting 50% apiece from the field as Keaton Cole knocks down another long three-point shot. So both teams are just lighting up here. It's very fun to watch.
Yeah, Cole right there around probably the exact same spot that he hit it earlier. And again, nothing but net. I mean, this kid, he could play in the NBA, I think, with the way that he shoots.
Only time he hit 90-plus three-pointers in a season, you know how to get it done from long range. This kid's just firing up from anywhere, and he's unconscious from the three-point line.
And that may have been Tawaski King drawing another foul there. It's going to be called on Boggs, but down low, Tyler Hood did a great job on the offensive rebound, and now he's going to get free throws.
Number 35, Tyler Hood, line to shoot two for the Bulldogs.
I'd like to see Weston get the ball into Tawaski King on this next play. He's been very quiet. He's yet to score. He's only grabbed two rebounds at this point. He's had a very quiet game. I think he's going out now, so maybe next time he comes in, they should try that. But he's very quiet. He's in a little bit of foul trouble also, so he's struggling. So hopefully Weston can continue the three-point shot, so they may get in trouble here soon.
Him and Boggs going to take a seat in for them, or Kenny Hall and James Sinclair, two young athletic players. Sinclair sets it up to Cole, gets it to Mutombo, back out to Cole, wide open, and he nails it again. And you can see the frustration on young Rajon Kelly's face as he left Cole open for a second, and Cole just hits another three.
And that's now his fourth three-pointer in the first half of this game. So that is, if you're Larry Hunter, you're absolutely pleased with the performance of Keaton Cole thus far as he pulls down a big rebound right there.
Hood from downtown couldn't hit it. Like you said, Cole came up with a rebound, and that brought Dylan Dunford on the bench up to his feet. He likes seeing the little man going up and getting the board. Mutombo gets it out to Sumler. To Cole, he thought about it again. Goes inside, out to Sumler, three-pointer, can't hit it. Rebounded way out by Mutombo. He's going to throw up a shot off the glass and out.
May have gotten bumped there. He seemed to think he got a foul. That's why he took the shot.
Not a bad possession there by the Catamounts, though. Sumler got an open look. He couldn't hit it. But with the way they're shooting right now, if you get open looks, keep on taking them. Wendler with a nice drive move, got up to the hoop and laid it home, bringing Samford within six.
That was a smooth move by the big man. Bad pass.
And they're going to get Sumler on a call right there for a trip, it looks like.
Oh, that was a bad call, Ryan. Happened right in front of us. There wasn't any contact there. He just tripped over his feet. Anyways, though, ref thought it was a foul. That's the call.
Well, you ref intramurally, and there are some calls that it seems like it should be based more on intent. And if it's unintentional, maybe you let it go. Right there, Merritt did a good job of coming up with the turnover and got the benefit of the doubt on the call. Ismael Hollis took a spill, throws up a shot, and almost hit it. Sinclair comes up with it, and we're going to have a foul call on Kenny Hall, it looks like. And Hunter Hooligan's not too happy about that one, as that is something that will bring the crowd to their feet in this building, is bad calls from the referees. They'll let them hear it.
And Samford's in the 1-1 in the first half already, so look for them to chip into this lead a little bit if they continue to get to the foul stripe.
And it's definitely something where, as Hood misses that one, so he won't get the second, but for Samford, if you can really start being physical down low now, looking for more fouls, not only to get to the line without necessarily even having a shooting foul, but also to get some of these key players in foul trouble.
Another turnover by the Catamounts, forced by the Samford defense. Looks like the zone's getting them some trouble.
And the Catamounts trying to work it inside a little more as Hood throws up another one from three. It's wide open, but he just does not have the range right now.
Well, they are the number 16th ranked nationally team in three-point shooting, so they're going to continue to jack it up, and I don't blame them. Those shots will fall eventually.
Now, Phil, for the Catamounts, offensive rhythm's gone down a little bit. When would you consider calling a timeout if you're Coach Hunter?
Well, right now you still got a six-point lead, and they're playing good defense. So as of now, I think you let them play. If they start to get in trouble or start to lose control, get a little spastic, then I think you call a timeout. But right now you get a timeout regardless, as it's a TV timeout.
Boggs with a move forced a foul from Cook. So we'll see the inbounds pass when we come back to TV62's coverage of Catamounts basketball. Back here at the Ramsey Center, Catamounts up 34-28 on the Samford Bulldogs. And Phil, this game was very run and gun early, a lot of big three-pointers. We haven't seen a lot else offensively, actually, besides three-pointers. And the shooters have gone a little bit cold here in the last few minutes. If you're a coach for either of these teams, what adjustment are you making offensively?
Well, it looks like Hunter wants to stick to the three-point game, as he just inserted Tom Tankiewicz in the lineup. We all know he's got range. He struggled a little bit shooting the ball this year, but he's also had limited playing time. But if he gets an open look, look for him to jack right on cue.
Tankiewicz right there with an open look, as you pointed out. Couldn't quite get that one to fall. But you got to develop a little bit of rhythm coming off the bench as well, so not a bad shot there. Kelly from downtown, and he hits it. And for the Catamounts right there, he had the ball the whole time. Where was the defense?
Yeah, that was pretty bad defense. Knowing at the three-point shooting ability that Samford has, I'm not sure why there was nobody in his face at all. He was wide open on that play.
And we mentioned Kelly in pregame. The freshman has averaged 11.5 points a game since making the starting lineup about a month ago. You got to keep an eye on him. Kenny Hall sends it out to Boggs. Someone looking to reset up the offense, looks to drive, sets up Tankiewicz, a shot from outside, and that one's not going to fall either. And we have got a blocking call, it looks like. Regardless of what it is, call is on Drew Windler of Samford. And so the Catamounts will keep the ball and refresh the shot clock.
Tom missed another shot on that play, but I think he needs to keep shooting. I personally played basketball in high school against Tom Tankiewicz, and he's got the ability to turn it on in a hurry. The man's got range. So if I'm Tom Tankiewicz, or if I'm Coach Larry Hunter, I'm going to tell the young guy to keep shooting.
I saw him lighten it up during practice a couple games ago when we covered the intramural night, and he's getting good looks right now. And I think that's the key, Phil, is that if you can get good looks, your coach is going to get mad with you for throwing them up. It's when you start taking contested shots that it becomes a problem.
And a lot of times players just need to see that first shot go through the net. Once they see them, once they splash that first basket in, they usually it's game on from then on out.
Boggs for three. He's been on fire all night. He hits another one, and shooting-wise, this is about as good as we've seen Boggs all year.
Yeah, this is just a three-point contest between both teams, but it's good to see Brandon Boggs step his game up. He's not really known for his outside shooting, but, you know, today he has been.
And he's going to need to continue as Windler from downtown. Couldn't hit that one, but rebounded by Cook. He's going to send it out to Merritt as Samford resets up their offense. Windler down low now on Tanglewitz, and he is going to be fouled hard. And that'll mean free throws for Samford.
And I like that. I like that foul by Tom Tanglewitz. You know, Wendell's a bigger man, so you don't want him getting an easy basket or a dunk. So you foul him hard, send a little bit of a message. But now he's got to go to the free throw line and earn it.
That's exactly right. And Wendler, we mentioned earlier, 6'9". Tom Tanglewitz is 6'4", so definitely a bit of a matchup problem down low for Tom. So if you're a coach, you're asking for good effort from him. Windler can't make his second. With less than a minute left here in the first half, Catamounts up by 5, looking for more. Keaton Cole back in the game for the Cats. Mutombo draws a foul down low from Will Cook, and he'll go to the line.
That was a good take right there by Mutombo. Good move, way to get yourself in position to attack the basket. Gets fouled, he's got a chance for free throws.
And what we've seen from Mutombo in the first half, maybe you'll agree with me, Phil, is a lot of team play. We saw him earlier come up with the offensive board and set up Sumler on the outside instead of just going up for a shot. Right there, down low, knows he can take Cook and does it, and then hits his free throw. So for Samford, I mean, this is a dual threat right there. This is a guy that sets up his teammates just as well as he can score himself.
Yeah, and he provides a matchup problem for Samford because he can do it all in every aspect. But if he's not scoring, which he struggled a little bit in this first half scoring the basketball, he's doing a little thing. He's rebounding. He's playing good defense. So he's doing the small things to contribute to his team, even though he's having a tough time scoring the basketball.
Cooked open. Hood rather open for 3, and that time he hits it. So we've seen him jack up a few of those earlier. Wasn't able to find the range, but that time, right on the money, brings Samford within 3 as the Cats, we've seen Trey Sumler do it before, click down the clock and look for a drive. Here he goes. Sets up Keaton on the outside of 3, and he hits it. What a way to end the first half if you're the Catamounts. Sumler setting up, looked like he was going to drive, and then last minute said, hey, there's Keaton Cole, let me just set him up.
Yeah, that was textbook. When Trey Sumler decided to penetrate, the defense collapsed on him, leaving Keaton Cole open for 3, kicked it out to him, buried the 3-point shot right before the half, giving the Catamounts momentum as they head into the locker room.
And it's like Sumler knew, because we talked about Samford running this zone defense. They haven't really changed out of it. They've done a good job of taking away the driving lanes from Sumler. He's tried to set up some screens. It hasn't really worked for him. That time, it's like he knew before he even started running towards the hoop that he was going to set up Keaton Cole.
And Keaton Cole's been absolutely unconscious from 3-point range tonight. He has 18 points, 6 of 9 shooting the 3-point shot. You're Larry Hunter, you're very pleased. He's carried this Catamount offense. So they scored 41 points in the first half.
And if you're going to give him open looks, he's going to keep on doing it in the second half. We're going to take a break here. When we come back, Purple Thunder is going to perform for our halftime entertainment. We'll be back with TV62's coverage of Catamounts basketball. We are back here at the Ramsey Center, and Phil, looking at some of the halftime stats, Keaton Cole, 6 for 8 from 3-point range, 18 points in the first half. Brandon Boggs, 4 for 6 from beyond the arc, 12 points in the first half. The team as a whole, 12 of 23 from 3-point range. They only have one shot that they made that was not a 3-pointer. And you mentioned to me right before he came back on that Keaton Cole, three more three-pointers here in this second half, and he breaks the season school record three-pointers in a season.
And right now, those two guys, Brandon Boggs and Keaton Cole, have accounted for 75% of the team's offense in the first half, scoring 30 to 41 points. So look for those two to continue it. But since it's only a six-point game here, I really think they need to try to find other options. Like, especially early, I think they need to go to Tawaski King, get him involved. He's scoreless. He's cold. He hadn't done much on the boards either. So I think just to keep the Samford defense honest, you got to go inside the Tawaski King, try to get some two-point baskets. You can't rely solely on the three-point shot.
And Trey Sumler is a guy who you might look to as well, looking for those driving lanes. He threw up four three-pointers himself in the first half, hit one of them, also had a two-pointer to go along with it. Haruna Mutombo getting to the line, 3 for 4 so far from his with his free throws. So if you're the Catamounts, you have a couple of options besides Tawaski King, who hasn't even taken a shot yet in this game, and that's definitely something I agree that you need to get him involved in the game. But you have a few other options here in terms of who can score for you.
And I'm sure Samford made an adjustment at halftime to figure out a way to guard this perimeter shooting by Weston. They're not going to let him sit back all day and just knock down 3 points. So look for Samford to maybe bring some sort of pressure here in the second half, knowing that the Western struggles with the full court pressure.
That should open up the interior a little bit for the Catamounts. We're going to send it down to Jake Myers for his halftime thoughts. Jake, down to you.
All right. Thank you, Ryan. Now, as you mentioned, the Catamounts have really lit it up here in the first half, in the early going of the first half, as it was. And Keaton Cole already has 18 points, which means 6-3 on the night for him already. And I agree with what Phil said. You got to go inside to Tawaski King. He doesn't have any field goal attempts at the moment, and you got to keep pounding it inside. They only forced about 3 fouls from the Samford Bulldogs in the first half. And also, I look for them to maybe pick up the pace a little bit more. In the early going of the first half, they were really pushing the ball up and down the court, especially down the court after missed opportunities for the Bulldogs. And they were really getting easy looks and a lot of open three-point shots to get that pretty solid lead in the first half. Hopefully, they can continue to do that. And if they can, then they can get an early big lead in the second half, hopefully stretch it out a little bit, make the Bulldogs claw back in. But I like what I'm seeing. They look great, and if they keep knocking down shots and they keep going inside, drawing a little more fouls, I think it'll be a really big game for them overall. Back to you, Ryan.
Thank you, Jake. And looking at the stats here, another thing we talked about during pregame and really throughout the first half there, as Samford did get into the bonus, was fouls. Catamounts had 8 in the first half, however, really evenly distributed, and so they're not really into foul trouble. The only player on the team that has more than one foul is Brandon Boggs with 2. Unfortunately for the Catamounts, that's your second leading scorer right now. So if you are Tawaski King, you only have 1 foul right now. You can afford to be kind of aggressive.
Absolutely. Look for him to be more aggressive. He's too important of a player to just be out there but not doing anything. We mentioned earlier Mutombo, even though he's not having the type of scoring night he wanted, he's doing the little things to help contribute to success. So I think Tawaski King needs to get in there, get his hands dirty, and help out a little bit.
Mutombo has 6 points, but he has 4 assists to go along with it and 2 offensive rebounds. Trey Sumler with 6 assists to go along with his 5 points, 5 defensive rebounds, and an offensive board as well. So 2 players that you expect to put up points tonight are doing everything except for putting up points. Second half starts, and Haruna Mutombo, as if on cue, goes for a 2, but couldn't quite hit it. Sends it out to the outside to Trey Sumler. Boggs back down low to Mutombo. Tawaski King fighting, gets the offensive board again. And a good play by King there early. And now we've got a discussion here for the rest, but early on there, couple offensive rebounds, Tawaski King with 1 of them, and we talked about King in the first half. Really, the only thing on the stat sheet that really sticks out is 3 defensive boards, no offensive rebounds. Right there, he changed that in a hurry.
I might have made him mad when I criticized him a little while ago.
Another thing to consider for the Catamounts, though, I mean, you put up so many three-pointers. You put up 41 points in the first half, and yet you're only up by six. So we thought this was going to be a defensive matchup, but Samford's offense, although from three-point range they have half as many three-pointers, still finding success.
And that's because they've created a bunch of turnovers.
And speaking about turnovers right there, Mutombo, I mean, we've mentioned it. He creates a turnover that time, sets up Brandon Boggs for an easy deuce. And that's the first deuce that Boggs has had tonight. Everything before that had been three-pointers. Merritt sets up Hood here. Cook gets it out to Windler. Back to Cook again. He hits Wood. Hood over to Cook. A shot from downtown. Goes off the front of the rim and right into the hands of Jeffrey Merritt. One of the fans calling for rebounds from the Catamounts, but Samford will look for the second chance and they will get free throws out of it. Drew Windler fouled by Mutombo down on the low post. Excuse me, not Mutombo, but Boggs. And that is unfortunate for the Cats because, as the PA announcer said, three fouls on Boggs already.
And these free throw shots were created by the second chance points by Samford because of the offensive rebounding. So far, their offensive rebounding has kept them in this basketball game and has given them second chance opportunities.
The hot dog comes out for the first time there. The Cat House Band, not effective though, as Windler hits them both. He's 3-for-4 from the charity stripe so far tonight. Brings Samford within six. And Phil, I hear from Kyle that you like that hot dog quite a bit.
I do. That is my favorite part of the Cat House Band. Anytime you see a dancing hot dog, it's hard not to crack a smile.
Haruna Mutombo, he wants to get in on the three-point game. Already had one, now he has two. And, you know, they're going to run out of three-point T-shirts down here, Phil.
I think Mutombo might have heard us when we were talking about his lack of scoring early in the second half. He said, take that, Phil Jackson and Ryan Keyes.
Everybody wants to prove us wrong tonight, Phil. Boggs blocked the ball away, and now the Catamounts with the possession. Keaton Cole from the sidelines, and he hits another. And that brings Larry Hunter up to his feet. He's clapping, he's cheering, he loves it as Keaton Cole hits number 7 of the night.
And that now is extending this lead to a double-digit lead, and Western's opened up their largest lead. That just gives Keaton Cole two free three-pointer shot of the all-time single-season mark here at Western Carolina.
And that single season record held by current assistant coach, Coach McCollum. Coach McCollum set that record with 99 three-pointers in the 95-96 season. And right now, Keaton Cole one away from tying it. And we talked to Coach McCollum the other day in the intramural basketball tournament. We got an interview with him after the men's A game, and you can tell he is a fiery competitor. He just loves basketball. His motor's running 100% at all times, and you got to believe that he feels great for Keaton Cole right now.
Bulldogs.
Foul on Tyler Hood, the redshirt freshman out of Kingston, Tennessee. Non-shooting foul, though, so Trey Sumler will inbound the ball. Gets it out to Mutombo. Back to Trey. Mutombo looking to drive, almost lost the handle on it. Back outside the box. He fakes, he shoots. And could not find the range, but gets heck. Mutombo's going to call that one a pass because it landed right in King's breadbasket, and he puts it in for two.
And those are Towaski King's first basket of tonight's contest.
And his first attempt as well, as he did not throw up a shot in the first half. Cook looking to drive, sets it back outside the Windler, and the center. 6'9", but he's got the range. He hits another three, brings Samford back to within 11.
That's so difficult to guard, too, when you have a big man who can step out and knock down a three-point shot. You got to worry about him killing you on the inside. Now you got to worry about him tearing you apart from the outside.
You're exactly right, Phil. We've seen him all game have success down on the post, and he's hit a couple threes on top of that. I mean, it is tough to guard. We've got our first media timeout of the second half. Score right now, Catamounts on a run of 51-40. We'll send it down to our sideline reporter, Jake Myers, when we come back to TV62's coverage of Catamounts basketball. We're back here at the Ramsey Center, and I'm going to send it down to Jake Myers for another sideline report. Jake?
All right. Thanks, Ryan. Now, in the early going, the Catamounts have really started hitting more three-pointers just like they did in the second half, and Tawaski Keene's been getting a little bit more involved on the offensive end, grabbed two offensive rebounds early, and the bench and the assistant coaches especially, they're really getting on their feet for Tawaski, working hard inside. And with the another three for Keaton Cole, making it seven for the game. The crowd's getting back into it with the three-point shots, and the hustle's there for the Catamounts. So hopefully they'll keep it up, keep the crowd in it, keep the bench in it, and it'll turn out to be a good game. Back to you, Ryan.
Thank you, Jake. And Catamounts have the ball back. Brandon Boggs gets it out to Sumler. Sets up Boggs for three. Can't hit that one. Tawaski King. Powerful offensive board, and he's going to go to the line for two.
You mentioned earlier, just a little while ago, that since Tawaski King only committed one foul in the first half, he was able to play more physical in the second half. We saw it right there as he ripped down that offensive rebound, sends himself to the charity stripe.
And on the offensive glass in the first half, Tawaski had zero offensive boards. Here in the second half already, we're not even 5 minutes into the half, he already has three offensive boards. He makes his first free throw. He'll hit them both, and the Catamounts climb back into a 13-point lead as this second half right now, they're outscoring Samford 12-5.
Weston's bringing a little bit of pressure here. We haven't seen this much today, but usually the press defense is very good, and they're able to force turnovers. Maybe that can lead to some quick baskets at the other end.
Easy buckets, and at this point, up by 13, you can afford to be a little more aggressive, because if you give up a few baskets, not that big of a deal. Merritt looking to get something going for his Bulldogs, gets it out to Cook, sets up Haven. Down the Windler, but we're going to have a call on Mutombo here. Tawaski King's going to take a seat for Kenny Hall, and we mentioned it at halftime, fouls have been a bit of a problem for the Catamounts here tonight. Not so much individual fouls as Mutombo takes another one. That'll be his third of the night and one as Cook made the shot, but you keep on giving this team fouls and you're sending them right to the line because of the bonus, which, I mean, you're up to 11 fouls now. That's four for this half. You're already quickly approaching the bonus.
Well, you're giving them unnecessary opportunities, too. I mean, the clock stopped. Even though you have a double-digit lead, with the clock stopped, Samford's able to chip into this lead, knocking down free throws. They're starting to come back a little bit with the clock stopped. So West needs to be a little bit smarter, play good defense. Defense is play with your feet, not your hands.
Cook could not finish the three-point play, and Mutombo gets the roll down low. We mentioned it at halftime, Haruna not having a huge offensive night in terms of points, but he's starting to get warmed up down there, and that could be trouble for the Bulldogs. We've got a foul call on Brandon Boggs, and that's his fourth, and St. Clair immediately subbed in for him, but this is not good if you're Larry Hunter. Your star player, who's really stepped it up tonight offensively, has four fouls already. And we've still got 14 minutes left in this game. Still plenty of time for things to happen.
Yeah, that's huge for the Catamounts and for Samford. The Catamounts now, their second leading scorer of the night heads to the bench. So now Samford look for them to take advantage with Boggs being on the sideline.
And Boggs has also had a very good game defensively. We haven't talked about it because of how good he's been offensively, but he's been very sharp. And Kenny Hall is going to take a foul. So already we've got five fouls on the board here against the Catamounts. Two away from the bonus. Good defense there off the inbounds pass, though. They'll force a turnover. Haruna Mutombo looking to drive. Lost his footing. Tried to send it out to Sinclair. And that is going to go out of bounds of the Catamounts.
And that ball was tipped right there. Obviously, we're not seeing things through the referee's eyes, but that was definitely tipped by a Samford defender. They got away with one there.
Well, the Cathouse band letting the refs hear it. Things starting to go Samford's way a little bit, but not really on the scoreboard, although Merritt is trying to change that. Big shot there brings it back to within 11. Sumler running the floor, hits Keaton Cole for the tie of the record, and he's got it. Keaton Cole ties Coach McCollum's record of 99 three-pointers on a season. School record here that was set in 95 and 96, and now, I mean, he's still got another game to go. It's not, I mean, he'll probably break it tonight with the way he's shooting. He's 8-for-10 from three-point range, but he could add another 10 against that.
Absolutely. Not only is he going to break the record, but it looks like he's going to set a very high mark for whoever comes after him.
And just to put the performance that Cole has had tonight in perspective, you got to think that maybe he knew a little bit about the record, because we've got it listed here that he had 10 three-pointers last week. Not last game, last week. Tonight, two more, and he's got 10 for a game.
I mean, shooting 10 three-pointers, hitting, making 10 three-pointers in a week is pretty impressive within itself, but 10 three-pointers in a game is just unheard of.
And the percentage right now, he's 80% from beyond the arc right now. I mean, absolutely incredible what he's done tonight. And Phil, it's a combination of two things. Not only is he hot, but he's choosing to shoot at the right times.
Also, the credit that to good ball movement by Weston. They've looked for the best shot rather than a quick shot, and they found him. He's got a lot of open looks, especially Trey Sumler. A lot of times he created the extra pass, and with his penetration, Samford has to respect his penetration ability. He's probably the quickest player on the court right now. Knowing that he can take it to the basket, they have to respect that. The defense collapses. That leaves Keaton Cole out on that three-point line all by himself.
Cole thought about shooting again there. Preston Ross comes in for his first minutes of the game. A very powerful rebounder takes Kenny Hall's spot. And Preston, an energy player, so it should be interesting to see what he can add to the team here. And on cue, Preston Ross with the offensive board off of the missed shot from Sumler. Puts in an easy layup. And the Catamounts up by 14 here, as I'm assuming this is Samford taking a timeout.
The Catamounts are using a 30-second.
And I assume wrong. It's what I get for assuming it's actually the Catamounts taking a timeout here. And Phil, right off the bat, Preston Ross with his first minutes of the game and comes up with a big play right off.
Yeah, he's very athletic. And so that play right there was just because he's just probably the most athletic player on the court right now. Just snatched that offensive rebound without even hesitation, went right back up and put it in.
And that's what he's done all season, Phil. It's not just about going up and getting the board. I mean, for him, it's this sort of energy and philosophy that if I'm going to go get a rebound, no one's even going to come near me. I'm just going to grab it and do something with it. And right there, perfect example, offensive board, puts it right back up off the glass and in.
He's also very, very strong. And so usually when he grabs that rebound, nobody's going to take it from him.
And we talked about it at halftime, Phil. The three-pointers are still falling for the Catamounts, but they're taking a lot less of them because we mentioned it at halftime. They wanted to start to find an interior game, because if the three-pointer starts to fail for you, then Samford's right back in the game. Here in this half, a lot more stuff down low, and next thing you know, they go from being up by 6 at halftime to being up by 14 here with 12:31 left in the game.
If you're Samford, though, you got to keep fighting. You've got to keep fighting. You're not playing terrible on the defensive side of the ball. Western's just shooting lights out. So I think keep up the pressure, keep the defense intensity. Maybe you bring some full court pressure here, knowing that Western struggles with the press. So look for that here in the future.
That's certainly something to think about. The Catamounts do turn over the ball a lot when they are pressed. And if you're Samford right now, you're getting to the point where there's really nothing left to lose. You still have plenty of time left in this game, down by 14, but you let it go a few more minutes and you have a problem. However, a nice response there as Brandon Heyman set up down low with no one around him as he blew by Sumler, puts in the easy two.
Well, that was a beautiful play. That was a beautiful backdoor cut and a good look from the outside from Samford. Got an easy basket.
Sumler looking to set up the offense. Sends it down low to Tawaski King. Back outside to Sumler. St. Clair open. Thought about taking the shot, decided better. Sumler throws up a shot with 4 seconds left of the shot clock and wasn't the prettiest thing we've seen all night. Is that just a bad possession offensively for the Catamounts or better defense by Samford?
I think a little bit of both. Samford was very active on the defensive side of the ball, but Western looked like they lost track of time there and just forgot that the shot clock was counting down. They had to throw up relatively ugly brick by Trey Sumler as time was winding down the shot clock.
Offensive rebound attempt by Connor Miller will go out of bounds on Miller himself, so it'll be Catamounts ball. We'll send it down to Jake Myers for another sideline report when we come back to TV62's coverage of Catamounts basketball. Center, Catamounts up 60-48, and we're going to send it down to Jake Myers with an interview in the student section. Jake, take it away.
All right, thank you, Ryan. I'm here in the student section of Ramsey and Hunter's Hooligans, and what's your name?
Cornelius Williams.
All right, and what major are you in?
I'm a CJ major.
All right, Cornelius. What do you think about the game tonight so far?
I'm really proud of the Cats right now. They're really moving the ball around. They're really shooting a three really well. I hope they don't rely on it in the tournament, but I like their shooting right now.
All right, Keaton Cole actually has tied the school record for most in a season with assistant coach McCullum. He has 99 right now. What do you think about his chances of breaking it tonight?
If he doesn't force it and just let the game come to him, I think he'll do well and he'll actually break it. But if he tries to force it, then he might put too much pressure on himself.
All right, now the Cats, they've turned up their energy the past couple of games. And they have a big game against App on Saturday here at home in the Ramsey Center. And then it's tournament time. What do you think about their chances in the tournament? And what do you think they might need to work on from this time?
In the tournament, I think they're going to play well if they stay together and play within the team. Not too much individual, more team basketball. As far as the way they're playing tonight, I like their energy. I like the way they're moving the ball. And all they need to do is keep it up. And I think they'll do well in the tournament.
All right. Thank you so much, Cornelius. You enjoy the game. All right, Ryan, back to you.
Thank you, Jake, and Keaton Cole taking something that wasn't a three that time and drawing a foul off of it.
I think everybody in the building was kind of surprised that he's actually shooting free throws now rather than jacking up a 40-foot three-point shot.
Well, I'm surprised that he took a two-pointer. That's the first one that he's shot all day. Everything has been beyond the arc for him. However, you can't criticize a guy if he gets to the line and makes those two as he makes his first.
Free throw is Keaton Cole's 25th point of the night, and we still have 10 minutes and 30 seconds left here in the second half.
Does not hit that one, but the rebound by Preston Ross forces another Samford foul. That one called on Will Cook, and you know, we talked about it. Preston Ross, he can jump over the rim.
That was just pure athleticism right there. The only thing that stopped him from jumping out of the stadium was, in fact, the roof. As he grabbed that ball, ripped it down, and got fouled.
Bruno Matomo receives the inbounds from Sumler, and he's going to draw a foul. This one called on Rajon Kelly. 16th foul for Samford. So both teams just a foul away from being in the one-on-one. Ross out to Mutombo. Mutombo, post up shot, and he hits it. Little spin move there from Mutombo.
And that was just a good move. He was very patient right there. Threw a little head fake in there to get the guy up in the air. Knocked it down.
Kelly setting up the offense for Samford. Down by 13, less than 10 minutes left in this game. The drive inside, and they're going to call Sumler there for the contact. So that's the 1-1 there, as Kelly will go to the line for three throws. This is one where if you're Kelly, you have to hit the first because Preston Ross is right down there waiting for the rebound. He knocks it down. And Phil, this is one way that Samford can get back into this game. If they can start hitting free throws, they're only down by 12 despite all the three-pointers against them. He hits his second, so they're down by 11 now, and just under 10 minutes left. There's still plenty of time. There's no need to panic right this second.
Oh, more than enough time, especially with the three-point shooting ability that Samford has. They can climb back into this ball game just as quickly as Western put all these points up on the board. They are leading the conference in three-point shooting, as we have said numerous times so far. So they are more than capable of coming back rather quickly in this ball game.
And for Samford tonight, they haven't really thrown up a lot of three-pointers, especially when you compare them to the Catamounts, who just time and time again shot them. But they are getting some twos right there. Merritt for three, and that one's in and out. Rebound was not controlled by the Catamounts, and now we're going to have some contact called on Haruna Mutombo, it looks like. So he may have gotten Heyman in the face there.
Samford foul.
That is going to be the... never mind. That is actually a foul on Heyman. I apologize to Mutombo. They got Heyman on the call there. And that's good news for the Catamounts, because if that had been on Mutombo, that would have been his fourth. Instead, it's the second on Heyman. And Mutombo will go to the line for the 1-1.
And we're going to be shooting free throws from now on for the rest of this game.
Kowalski King, offensive board, couldn't control it. Preston Ross chases it down. Mutombo drive, draws the foul. And Haruna Mutombo right there, aggressive drive to the basket. Forces Hood to take the foul, and that'll mean more free throw shots for the Catamounts.
Both teams are very aggressive on the defensive side of the ball, but both teams have to be smarter here. They're committing a lot of dumb fouls. We got 15 combined fouls here in the second half with more than 8 minutes to play.
And it's been an interesting game to watch because it's been very offensive. If they're not hitting three-pointers, they're going to the line because of all the fouls. If you're a coach for either one of these teams, though, I mean, you can't really be too happy about that. Yeah, you're happy with your offensive production, sure, but defensively, you got to be a little upset with how your teams have played.
Yeah, if this continues, we may be watching the second string from both teams finish out these last minutes in the game.
Mutombo will hit both that time. Catamounts back up to 13, and right now Samford has hit this problem where they'll keep on drawing it back into 11. But they can't seem to get any closer than that. Hood for three. He hits it. Nothing but mesh for Tyler Hood, the redshirt freshman out of Tennessee. And he brings his team back to within 10. Cole, nice bounce pass down low to Mutombo. He tried to set up King. Sumler saves the play and gets it back out to Cole. Sumler driving, sets up Cole. Well defended by Kelly. Catamounts offense very patient right now. 7 left on the shot clock. Sumler looking to set up. Sets up Cole. He needs to throw up a shot. Tried to draw contact, no call. Very well defended there by Samford.
Absolutely. They never once let down the defensive intensity right there. They forced a turnover.
And that's something that, especially on the three-point shot, we did not see that from Samford in the first half. Right there, Rajon Kelly, little too quick to be covered by Tawoski King, who currently is trying to encourage the crowd to get into this game. They've been kind of quiet, and now Samford pulling to within 8.
That was poor defense by Tawoski King as well. you should never, ever, ever give up the baseline. It's the quickest way to the basket, and he left a wide open lane for Kelly to get inside.
Foul going to be called on Preston Ross there as there was a scramble for the ball. We've got another media timeout here. We will be back with TV62's coverage of Catamounts basketball. Catamounts currently up 65-57. Back here in the Ramsey Center, we've got a good game going on so far, just like we expected. Phil, Catamounts looking for a big win here. If they can get it, they're tied in the North Division with Appalachian State, and then they'll have a game on Saturday, a doubleheader that we will be covering here on TV 62. They're the first game of the doubleheader in which they'll play Appalachian State to decide who will be the fourth seed in the North Division.
That will also be senior nights. So what better way for these seniors to go out on top than by beating your arch rival in the last matchup of the regular season? But let's not get ahead of ourselves. We still got 7 minutes to play here.
That is a good point, and only up by eight, that can change in a hurry, especially in college ball. Here's Hood for three. He hits it, and prime example of how it can change right there. Big time open three by Hood, and Samford's within five. This lead was 13 just seconds ago. And Drew Windler has 19 points for Samford right now. We haven't talked about him a lot, but that post game, along with the outside shooting, has worked very well for him. He's taking a rest on the bench right now, but he is a dangerous player, and he's proved it so far tonight.
Western needs a big stop right here. You're on the wrong end of a little bit of a run, so you need a big defensive stop here to maybe get you going in the other direction.
It's something to think about, Phil. Samford has finally started to cover those three-point shots. They're not leaving them wide open anymore, and the Catamounts having problems driving down low as Jeffrey Merritt, no problem driving down low, gets the foul from Sumler. Sumler's third foul, and that'll mean more free throws for Samford, who is one away from the double bonus. King comes back in for Kenny Hall. And we've got the original starting lineup back out there for the Cats. King, Mutombo, Boggs, Sumler, and Keaton Cole.
Ooh, looks like he got away with a little bit of a walk right there.
Friday comes up with the offensive rebound, may be a walk, but no call. So Samford will keep possession of the ball. Hood, what a pass! Right over the head of two defenders. Right on Friday for the easy two, and Samford back within three here with 5:50 left in the game.
And this is the first time we've seen Samford really be able to successfully run their offense. They've been getting what they want offensively. Using the screens, the backdoor cuts. The Catamounts have done a poor job defending it as Samford's getting layups almost every time down the court.
Poor defense there. Sumler, however, responds with a three ball as he was left wide open. Friday, no look past the Hood for three, and that one's not going to fall, but Heyman with the rebound, or maybe not, and we are going to get a foul call. As that just became a mess. Mad scramble for the ball there. And they are going to get Rajon Kelly for his third foul of the game there, which will lead to Keaton Cole at the line again. Great effort. As Keaton Cole, all 5'10 of them there, fighting for the basketball.
And as this game winds down, both teams are starting to pick up the physicality down low because every possession means so much when a game that's this close with this much time left.
It's definitely transitioned into an interior game, Phil, and Keaton Cole can't make his first, rebounded by Samford, and these free throws are going to become more and more important for both teams as we got a six-point game, both teams on the verge of double bonus. You got to hit your free. You got to hit your free throws. Coach Hunter has Ishmael Hollis ready to come into the game for the Cats. Kelly set up down low. He can't make the layup. And it's been kind of a frustrating game for Rajon Kelly. He has 9 points, but it's been torn up on the defensive boards, on the defensive end, and right there, missed an easy layup. And then on the other end, Mutombo says, come here, young timer. Let me show you how it's done.
And that was a heck of a move on Mutombo. He's able to get to his right, banking up the glass. And Samford takes the timeout here because their coach is not happy with that poor display of defense on that end.
But it all starts with the execution on offense, Phil. I mean, if you make the easy layup, your defense goes down the court, gets set up, and they're ready to go. When you miss the easy layup that everybody expects you to get, this Catamounts team does not play. They run right down the court on transition buckets, and if you're on defense, you got Rajon Kelly over here moping because he missed the layup. So you got 4 guys down there already. You're out of position.
Yeah, it was a 4-point turnaround. Instead of being able to cut the game down to 4, it's back up to 8.
That's a great point. You give up 2 on one end. You miss 2 on one end, rather, and then you give up 2 on the other, and that's a good way to get out of a game in a hurry. Windler for 3. Hits it again. Drew Windler joining Keaton Cole on the over 20 points crowd. As he hits another 3, he's been able to do it all for Samford today.
And he's been the workhorse for them. He's kept them in the game even when they were down by 15 early in this game. He was still hitting big shots both inside and outside. So he's been doing his job.
Keaton Cole, congratulations to you. You have the record as he hits another one. 9 for 11 from 3-point range tonight. That is number 100 for the season. Only Catamount in the history of our basketball team to be able to do that. What a season for Keaton Cole from beyond the arc. And Phil, first guy up on his feet was Coach McCollum, the old record holder, all the way up on his feet, cheering for his player. Got to be pretty proud. Yeah, you lose your own record, but you got to coach the kid that took it away from you. So maybe some mixed emotions, but for the most part for Coach McCollum, he seemed pretty thrilled about that one.
Yeah, when that shot hit the bottom of the net, I looked over at Coach McCollum and he just cracked a smile. So obviously, I'm sure he wants to continue being the leader, but he doesn't mind losing the record to somebody like Keaton Cole.
Fans up on their feet for Keaton Cole, giving him a standing ovation. What a season he has had. And we've got a media timeout here. Catamounts up 73-65. We'll send it down to Jake Myers one last time when we come back to TV62's coverage of Catamounts basketball. Cameras all over Keaton Cole as we come back here in the Ramsey Center. Keaton Cole has just set the record for 3-point shooting in a season here in Western Carolina. We'll send it down to Jake Myers. Jake, what have you got for us?
Well, as you just mentioned, Keaton Cole just broke the record for the most 3-pointers in a season with 100. And the fans here, they're on their feet. They're still on their feet as the Bulldogs are shooting free throws. And hopefully the fans will be into it for the end of the game. It's going to come down to probably free throw shooting. Both ends of the floor are going to be really hot. Hopefully the fans will stay involved. The bench is getting really excited. And hopefully we can pull out a win in this one to make everybody excited for the rest of the night. Back to you, Ryan.
Thank you, Jake. Great work tonight. And he mentions a good point here. A record like that can certainly get the crowd on their feet. It did. The student section still on top of it. And it can be that energy from the crowd that catapults the Catamounts to victory here tonight. Ish Hollis going to be called for a foul there as he went for the rebound on Will Cook, and some complaints from the crowd. What did you think about that call, Phil?
Oh, I thought it was a good call. You can't grab a guy by the arm and yank him down on the floor. So regardless of what the crowd's doing, I think the official made the right call there. And I can also tell him I know how you feel, buddy, making a call and getting booed for it.
Yeah, we've got the replay there, and certainly looked like a lot more contact there from Ish than what was necessary. And so far the rest of the night, there have been spurts where it's gone one way or the other, but for the most part, I mean, you can't really complain. It's been pretty consistent. Both teams are almost in the double bonus, so you can't really say that one team has had more fouls than the other. Samford down by 7. Brandon Boggs gets the ball over to Sumler, gets it out to Keaton Cole. He's been deadly tonight. Over 80% from downtown. Mutombo looking to drive, gets it out to Sumler. 12 seconds left on the shot clock. Sumler looking for a driving lane, hits it to Mutombo. 6 seconds left. Needs to throw one up, does. It's blocked away by Windler, sends it up again, and yeah, that one's not going to fall. Will Cook with the rebound. And Phil, we've seen that more and more in the second half, just pass, pass, and Samford just keeps on coming defensively. The Catamounts are not finding the open looks that they had in the first half.
Yeah, like you said, that's now the third or fourth time we've seen the shot clock. The Catamounts have to jack up a shot right before the shot clock expires. And right there, Mr. Windler right there stayed on his feet. Blocked the shot of Mutombo.
Three ball, Kelly, and he'll hit it. Samford cuts the lead down to 2 with 2:15 here left in this game. I mean, we talked earlier, plenty of time to dwindle away that lead. And right now, they're right on the rear bumper of the Cats with 2 minutes left on the clock. Phil, what kind of adjustments do the Catamounts need to make here? Because slowly but surely, it hasn't come in a big spurt or one big run, but just consistent basketball by Samford here in the second half has got them back in the game. What do you need to do if you're the Catamounts to at least hang on to this one?
Well, right now I think you need a big basket on this offensive possession to stop the bleeding. You've seen your 15-point lead dwindle down to just a 2-point lead. Crowd's a little out of it, so I think right now you take a good shot, you work the shot clock, and you get a great shot. Put some points, extend your lead a little bit.
Keaton Cole sets up Sumler. Back to Cole, he gets it out to Sumler.
Physical battle down low between Windler and King.
Trey, fake, shot, and a little contact there. Sumler was not able to step into the shot the way he wanted to, and it fell way short.
And now Samford has the opportunity to tie or perhaps take the lead here.
We've seen them start to get a little hot from three-point range. That time they set it inside to Jeffrey Merritt, and no one was down low, as that was probably the easiest bucket you're going to get.
There it is. There's that Princeton-style offense, pick and roll and backdoor cuts. The Catamounts are having a lot of trouble defending that. So if I'm Samford, I'm going to stick with my bread and butter and continue to do that until they prove they can stop it.
And the Catamounts offense has gone dry here the last couple possessions. Boggs' pass. Trey Sumler not ready for it. Coach Hunter not happy about it. And he is going to take a timeout here with a minute left in this game. The Catamounts, believe it or not, were up by 14 at some point in this half. Now with only a minute left, it's a tie ball game, and Samford has all the momentum here. Now, Phil, if you're Samford, I mean, you already mentioned you're going to go right back to that same play again because of how effective it was. How do you defend that if you're the Catamounts?
Well, the Catamounts, you got to communicate. You got to call out the screens. They haven't been doing that, and not only has Samford been wide open every time, but the Catamounts, they get caught up in the screen, and both players are getting stuck in the screen, so it's been a little bit of a lack of communication. So you got to communicate, especially with there only being a minute left. I expect Samford to use all 35 of those seconds on the shot clock to get a good look. So if you're Western, big stop right here so you can give yourself an opportunity to win this game.
Huddle's going to break here for the Catamounts. You got to believe that the Cats, who have been in a lot of close games this year, a lot of those have not fallen the way they've wanted to, especially within the SoCon, which explains a large part of the 6-10 SoCon record. They've been a lot better within the conference than what the record implies, but when you lose a lot of close games, it gets tough, and you got to believe that this team right now wants to just keep on going here and get the win here because of how big of a lead they had earlier in the game. As we have another timeout by the Catamounts. They're going to take the floor here. Samford also taking the floor. Samford with the ball and a chance to take the first lead that they've had since the first half.
It looks like the Catamounts are going to pick up full court pressure here to maybe aggravate the Samford offense.
That's what they were showing, but they don't bring as much pressure on the ball carrier as you would expect.
Also here, be careful not to pick up a stupid foul. It's double bonus for both teams now. You can't foul them and send them to the free throw line to give them a chance to take the lead.
Although Samford has struggled from the free throw stripe so far tonight, Merritt trying to post up on Sumler. That ball falls short, and Trey Sumler, not only with the great defense, but with the board as well. And now they're going to take a foul on Sumler. Will Cook not liking that call at all, complaining to the ref, but right now Sumler going to go to the line for two.
And that right there was textbook defense by the Catamount on the other end. Got to stop, push the ball up the floor, get the ball in the best ball handler hand, and you go into the free throw stripe.
Well, Coach Hunter right there trying to get the focus back within his team during those timeouts, trying to say, guys, defense is what got us to this point in the game to begin with. We got to keep on playing it. It turns out very well as Trey Sumler did a great job down low on Merritt, who's been dangerous so far tonight. He's had quite a few points, and Sumler, he guards it. He comes up with his own rebound, goes right down the court and draws the foul. We've got another timeout call here with 25 seconds left. Catamounts up by one. We'll send it down to Jake Myers for one last update from the sideline. Jake, down to you. Oh, we've got some technical difficulties down there, but Phil, Jake's doing good work today, so have you, but down with 25 seconds left in the game. You're up by one. You've got one more free throw left to take with Sumler. How do you finish off this game if you're the Catamounts to guarantee that you're going to get the win? Because you know that Samford, because they forced the free throws, are at least going to have one more possession.
Well, first and foremost, you got to make this free throw to ensure a two-point lead. And then on the defensive side, you do exactly what you just did on the previous possession. Tight defense, stay in your man shorts. But whatever you do, do not give up a three-point opportunity. Don't let a Duke and Carolina thing happen right here where you allow the ball handler to just dribble the clock down and take a three-point shot. If you're Western, you cannot allow Samford to take a three-pointer shot here.
Sumler nails the free throw. Catamounts up by two. And if you're Samford right now, 24 seconds left, do you go for the tie or do you go for the win?
I think you go for the tie. Your offense has been working this point. You go for the tie.
Merritt cannot hit the easy layup. They gave it to him, and you can see the disappointment in his body language is right there. They gave him baseline. You mentioned it earlier. You can't do it. They did. Catamounts got lucky there, and then Windler almost came up with the rebound, but Mutombo gets his hands on it. Catamounts breathing a sigh of relief here with 14 seconds left as Merritt right to the hoop.
Yeah, Samford right there blew a golden opportunity. They had that. It was there. The play was there. Wide open. What could you want? He did everything but finish.
Mutombo gets the lucky bounce there. The iron kind that time. As Mutombo able to make the first, and if he can hit this second one, Catamounts up by two possessions. He does it in style there. Nice swish. Catamounts up by four. Crowd on their feet finally here at the Ramsey Center. We're down to under 10 seconds left. Windler for three. Hits it. And we still got a ball game here, Phil.
My goodness, that was clutch right there. Windler, not even phased, just steps back, knocks down a long three-point shot, cut to a one-point game. Looks like we're going to have another fantastic finish here. You know Samford's going to foul, so you have to hit your free throw shot.
And if you're Larry Hunter right now, your main focus has got to be, guys, we've got to be solid with the inbounds pass, and we've got to get it to one of our better free throw shooters.
And first and foremost, you got to get the ball inbounded. That's what you got to do. You got to protect it. If you go to the free throw line here, if you're Western, you hit both foul shots, you'll be up by three. So I think if you're Western, you might want to foul Samford when they get the ball to prevent them taking a three-point shot. Make them shoot two free throws. Even if they hit both free throws, they're still down by a point.
That's something that the Catamounts has had done to them before against Furman. In this building, Catamounts were down by three. Furman fouled them, and that was pretty much the end of the game. Interesting setup there as Trey Sudler passed it out to Keaton Cole, who was still out of bounds, and then Keaton Cole did the inbounds pass.
And you don't see that too often, but that play was definitely well run by the Catamounts and got the ball into Sumler. And now, point guard is supposed to be your best free throw shooter, which he is. He shoots over 80%. So if you're Western, you have the right man at the free throw line. And we'll see right now if how clutch he is.
Sumler sharp from the line, and Hunter does not care about a rebound right now, talking to all four of the players, probably going to set them all back to play defense. Substitutions in for Samford. They had a defensive package out there before. Now they're getting their offensive players back in the game.
And don't be surprised that if someone hits this free throw, that the Catamounts do foul Samford to make them shoot free throws rather than giving them the opportunity to hit a three-pointer.
Sumler hits a second. Catamounts up by three. The cheerleading squad likes it. A couple seconds left, they're going to foul. Kelly throws one up. That's not going to count anyway, and he hit the shot clock. With 1.1 seconds left, I mean, there's really only one option for Kelly now.
And there it is. The foul. You foul him, send him to the free throw line. You make him make two free throws. Even if he hits both of them, they're still down by a point. So I think that was heads up by the Catamount coaching staff.
And so the thought for Kelly is, make the first one, which he does, miss the second one and hope for some sort of tip-in. And with 1.1 seconds left, not a lot of time to do that either, as Samford, it looks like, is going to take a timeout here.
That's really your only option, though. If you make the free throw, you can foul them, but there's not going to be enough time for you to get the ball back and get a decent look. So I think you have to miss it on purpose. Maybe you get a lucky bounce and can get a decent shot.
And it's not going to be easy because as soon as that ball comes off the rim, clock starts up again. And if there was 2 seconds left, maybe three, maybe you're able to rebound it and put it back up. But in this kind of situation, really the only option you have is the tip. Because if you bring it down, you're not going to have time to bring it back up. Go, last play of the night, and we have a lane violation there. Brandon Boggs, he doesn't want to give up the rebound on Samford. He was in the lane about 5 seconds early.
That's a little bit questionable, though, because Kelly double-clutched on that free throw, so that could have been a lane violation on Samford for the double-clutch.
Kelly misses intentionally. It's rebounded by Sumler. Who else but the star player, Trey Sumler? He has had at least 7 boards tonight, and that's a big one. And the Catamounts, they take a sigh of relief as Samford clawed their way back into this game. They just kept coming. But ultimately, the Catamounts win it and advance to 7-10 in the North Division of the SoCon.
And that was a big win for the Catamounts. They've now won 3 in a row. They have a lot of momentum heading into Senior Day on Saturday against your arch rival, Appalachian State. So they're getting hot at the right time.
And that's certainly something to think about as Phil I hear that you have a prior engagement, so we're going to try to get Kyle Rush over here to start running the post-game show. But certainly something until he comes over here. The app game, always a big one. We had a big game here last year at the Ramsey Center. The place was packed as Kyle Rush is coming over here now. But a one-point win against them last year on a last-second shot. Do you expect something similar this year?
Absolutely. It's a rivalry game. Rivalry games are always close. It doesn't matter the talent level of each team. It's just the emotion. I expect a packed house here at the Ramsey Center on Saturday. Look for a tight matchup between two rival schools. Looking to gain momentum heading into the SoCon tournament.
All right. Thank you, Phil, for your work today. Always a pleasure working with you. And we got Kyle Rush, TV62's usual men's play-by-play announcer. I had to sub in for him today. But, Kyle, you got to announce that App State game last year. And we saw a very close game here today against Samford. Sets up the Catamounts to where they're 7-10 in the SoCon Conference. We have App State listed as 7-9, so basically tied in the North Division. Whoever wins it takes fourth in the North Division. What are you expecting out of both teams here on Saturday night?
I'm expecting a war, Ryan. I really am, because that's what this matchup's always about. It's always physical. It's always the most physical two games of the year. It's always the most hardest fought, and it's always usually one of the closer games the Catamounts will play all year. Expect a dogfight in a hostile environment Saturday.
Last year, Western won both games against App State. This year, they were defeated in Boone 84-72 on January 21st. They'll be looking for revenge here in Cullowhee. Game is scheduled for 2 o'clock. TV 62 will be bringing you the doubleheader, as not only do we have the men's game, but then after that, we have women's basketball against Georgia Southern. You've watched both teams all year long. Do you think they're ready for SoCon tourney time?
I do. I think this win for the men's side is huge. It gives them 3 wins in a row. They're starting to hit their stride, Ryan, and I think we've seen that today. That first half especially, the Catamounts have been waiting for a performance like that where they feel like they hit their potential. They did that today, and they're starting to win the close ones now. So I think the rest of the conference has to be ready for them.
And one last note, Kyle. Today, Keaton Cole obviously broke the school's single-season three-point record. He's hit 100 on the season, hit 9 today, had 10 last week for the entire week. Today, 9 in one game. What do you have to say about Keaton Cole and his performance throughout this season?
And there's a reason he's nicknamed Keaton Knockdown Cole. I mean, it's not a surprise to anybody in this league or anybody that's played Western Carolina. He's a spot-up shooter. That's what he does. Appalachian better be ready for him, because the last month or so, he's been on fire.
He was 9 for 12 tonight. And we will have our last basketball game of the year on Saturday. We will be covering Appalachian State on the men's side at 2 o'clock. Then we'll be covering the women's game at around 4:30 against Georgia Southern. Until then, for Philip Jackson on color commentary, Kyle Rush here on the postgame show, and Jake Myers on the sideline, this has been Ryan Keyes with TV62's coverage of Catamounts basketball. Catamounts win tonight here at the Ramsey Center, 79-77.